Well, I am delighted to be here, even if I'm the wrap-up speaker, whatever it's called. And I'm going to have a little fun with you folks today, and I hope you decide to have a little fun with me. Because when I was thinking about this talk and the lessons that I've learned in project management, I thought, you know, I should probably go back a little while and look at some historical data. It's possible that the very first project manager was also an architect. And I'm probably going to say his name wrong. Imhotep. I can't quite get the name right. I have it written down correctly, but I've only seen it written. I haven't actually practiced except to me to talk it out, so I probably said it wrong. Was the very first architect for a pyramid. Now think about a pyramid. Pretty complex, a non-trivial architectural problem to solve, and senior management, who probably had a lot to say about whether or not the project was successful. In fact, so much to say that there was a pretty good chance that if you were not successful with the project, you might actually be dead. Now, it turns out that we now call schedules frequently deadlines. And I thought, well, I wonder where that came about in the project management literature. So I looked it up. It's not a project management term. It turns out that in the US Civil War, there were military stockades, and prisoners of war were supposed to stay inside the inside fence. But between the inside fence and the outside fence was a bunch of space, and there were 14 to 17 feet. And somewhere in that 14 to 17 feet, if you stayed inside the 14 to 17 feet, you got to live another day. You step 1 foot outside that boundary, and they were allowed to shoot to kill. That is the actual origin of the word deadline. Now, isn't that interesting how we use deadlines now in our projects? I am hoping that none of you have actually been killed and have come back as vampires. No? You're all living. Okay, good. Because if you were, you know, we'd have to have another discussion about paranormal stuff. But we don't. We can keep talking about project management. So it's very interesting if you start looking at complex projects, we have schedules and we now call them deadlines. What does that have to do with software projects? Well, software projects are different in a number of dimensions. They are actually the most complex endeavor that anyone in human history has tried to accomplish. Right, think about that. The most complex endeavor. And do we get any respect? No. But not only are they the most complex endeavor, you can't actually see them as they're built. Right? How do you see something that's a bunch of zeros and ones? How do you see what's actually there? How do you manage the risks? How do you manage those deadlines and schedules? And that's the kind of thing that I really wanted to try and talk about, because a lot of organizations have said, we will find our process. We will have one process. We will anoint it. We will crown it. We will make it the process for all time and all projects. Wouldn't you like to have one of those? I would. I really would. But one of the other things I've learned about software projects is not only are they the most complex and the most ephemeral and the most risky, one process does not actually work for all projects. Now, a lot of you are thinking, well, we're agile, or we're waterfall, or we're something else, and we make it work. With the work of determined people, you can make any life cycle work in any situation. But your process is not just your life cycle. Your process is your life cycle plus all of the technical and management practices. So you see how it's just about impossible to have one process that works for everything? It boggles the mind. And so when I was thinking about how do I get some stuff across about lessons that I've learned in project management, I thought, well, let me talk about what a pragmatic project manager does. A pragmatic project manager chooses a life cycle that works for this project. And as much as I love Scrum, which is my preferred project management life cycle, it doesn't actually always work for everything. Sometimes I use a straight iterative life cycle, although pretty rarely. Sometimes I use a fairly incremental life cycle, and I'll be talking about these in a few minutes. And every so often, I actually use a serial life cycle. But I change the technical and management practices to go along with whatever life cycle I'm using to get the most out of the particular life cycle. So I'll be talking about life cycles that work for your context. Now, one thing that I think is completely context dependent is how you plan to replan. And I have some suggestions for that, so we'll be talking about that. And I really like prototyping to see where we're going with this product. Sometimes you don't actually need prototyping. So those of you who don't need prototyping, if you really have to snooze during that part of the talk, please don't snore, just snooze. And one of the things that I've done for years is implementing by feature, especially before selecting an architecture. I used to think it was because I was stupid, but it turns out I'm not actually so stupid. Most of us have a really hard time choosing an architecture before we've tried to put anything together. Now, the one thing that is not context dependent that I'm pretty sure I can say to each and every one of you is that you should never multitask. Now, those of you who are managers are saying, okay, JR, you know, give me a break. I have to multitask to get my job done. So the context for always saying no to multitasking is that you do technical work at a relatively up until the very highest architecture level, right? The technical staff cannot afford to multitask. So we'll talk about that too. So let me talk a little bit about the inevitable serial life cycle. Some of you may know this as a stage gate. Some of you may know this as a waterfall. And let me give the serial life cycle a little bit of credit. There was a time when, at the end of the requirements phase, we actually had a re-estimation of the project, a re-estimation of the amount of time it was going to take and the cost that it was going to take, the people it would require. And so we would do requirements and have a management review. And in order to do a good management review, we had to re-estimate. And life was challenging, but not so bad. We were able to do this. And we did it at the end of the analysis, at the end of design, at the end of code, at the end of integration, at the end of test. And I won't tell you that life was perfect, because when I was a project manager 20 or so years ago trying to do this, and my boss said to me, so how much more time is it going to take, JR? And I'd say, I don't have any freaking idea. That was not a good answer. But I was expected to re-estimate the time, and I was expected to re-estimate the cost and the people. And are those people going to be ready for me to scooch off onto this next project was always the question. And it was challenging, but for the projects that we did between 20 and 30 years ago, it was possible. Not easy, but possible. I no longer think it is possible to do this. We have done all of the easy projects. We only have the hard stuff left. And if you have the hard stuff left, a serial life cycle is not the thing that works. Now, the interesting thing is there are a few times where you can make a serial life cycle work. If you have something called a hot fix or an urgent patch or the customer, the very important customer that's on the phone to your CEO, and it really will take just two or three people, just two or three or 4 weeks, and you know precisely what you have to do and your team's not going to change and the requirements aren't going to change, and the architecture's not going to change, you could make a serial lifecycle work. It's possible. But that's just about the only time where you can make it work. One of the kinds of serial lifecycles I've met, and I encountered this one when I was doing an assessment for a very large engineering organization. They said, we get all the requirements up front. They were very clear. They got their requirements. They knew what to do. This is in a 2 to 3 year engineering project with hardware, software, and many millions of lines of code. We know what we have to do at the beginning of this project. And I said, don't things change? Well, yes, but we handle that. Okay. And so we understand how to do architecture. We have the world's best architects. And I think they might have, because their products were quite complex and quite difficult to do well. And then we understand how to take that architecture and move it into design. And we have fabulous developers. They can code anything. And they keep to their schedules. So far, we have not had a slip in any of our schedules. And we get to integration, and we integrate the whole thing. And then what do you think happens? The testing starts. And it goes, and it goes, and it goes, and it goes, and it goes. And we thought we had a 2-year project. It turns into a 3-year project. What the heck is wrong with our testers? Now, when they explained this to me, that wasn't actually my initial reaction, that there would be anything wrong with the testers. So I asked the people who do the requirements, and I said, how do you know you have all the requirements? They said, we don't. In fact, we're pretty sure we don't have many of them. We're pretty sure of that because of all the changes that happen. And I talked to the architects and said, so how do you know you've got a good architecture? And they said, well, we have the best minds in the business, JR. Okay. How do the developers take that architecture and translate it into design? Well, some of it's a little difficult because the PowerPoint pictures don't always translate into reality. Any of you guys dealing with PowerPoint architects? You have my sympathies if you are. And then, of course, by the time we get to integration, I said, usually problems that show up in testing tend to manifest themselves in integration. And one of the release engineering guys said to me, not if all you have is stubs. Things integrate just fine with stubs. And I said, oh, okay. And then the first time anyone could see anything about the product was in test, right? Because the testers would try and test the features and nothing happened. So it was a very interesting misapplication of the serial lifecycle. One of the things that these folks did was they said, well, if we have such trouble with the requirements, if we could just get the requirements right. Have you seen this kind of thing happen in your organizations? I swear, everyone says if we just could get the requirements right, the hands are going up and down. Sometimes you say, you see this, it's the guillotine coming down on somebody's head. And so they spend a lot more time on requirements. And sometimes, especially for smaller projects, certainly not 2-year projects, you might even have it work if you have some overlap of the phases. This top picture has been something that has worked with difficulty, with great difficulty, for any number of companies. But what I more often see is the bottom picture, where we spend all this time in what I call requirements hell, and then we still do the analysis, design, coding, integration, and we do just enough testing so no one sues us. And sometimes it's not quite enough testing and people do sue you. So the problem with the serial lifecycle is it's good for a very limited number of projects. And every single project I have ever worked on, except for the very smallest, there's an enormous amount of change, right? Sometimes you're lucky and it's just a little bit of change. And so the reason that we call it a waterfall is that the ideas flow down from requirements. You know, you think about the flow down, requirements analysis, design, code integration, test. And then it, when change happens, it's like a salmon swimming upstream. And that's fine, but what I more often see is that it's not just one thing that changes. It's a whole lot of things that change. You have that one little change, that one little small salmon going upstream, and that provokes any number of other changes. And now you've got a swarm of changes, and you have to try and figure out how do we put them into the system. And the answer is sometimes you get lucky and the bear doesn't take you down, right? And you can do it. Sometimes you miss the bear on the way up and things are good. But more often you get eaten by the bear. And I'll tell you, I really don't like being in this position, because what I get as a result is I'm not happy with the project. The developers aren't happy. The testers aren't happy. The business analysts are fit to be tied, right? That's not what I wanted. We told you what we wanted, and your boss is truly unhappy. And that's when I said, over 20 years ago, I can't afford to do this anymore because I really don't like this result. It's just too hard. So one of the things I started doing many, many years ago was using a form of iterations that I call prototypes. So we prototype some pieces, and if you have an iterative life cycle, one of the ways that I did this in a project was we spent some time gathering the requirements. I actually time boxed that amount of time because if you've ever worked with a group of, the only word I have for it is anal. System engineers. They wanted to dot every I, cross every T, even though we had no idea what the product was going to look like. And I finally said, this is it. We're going to give you this much time, and then we're going to prototype a little bit over here, and prototype a little bit over there, and prototype a little over here, and prototype a little over here. And as we continue prototyping, I tried to get the project team to integrate and test as we went, but that was just too much. That was way too avant-garde for them. But we prototyped lots of pieces of the system. So by the time we were ready to start integrating, we understood how things were going to go. And because we'd prototyped and gotten feedback, we were able to talk to our systems engineers and say, what do you think of this? It's just a prototype. You know, don't worry. Because sometimes if you have people who really want the definition of the requirements, looking at prototypes makes them kind of crazy. So fine, we have prototypes, and that made it much easier for them to succeed. We didn't have the real problem of requirements lasting forever. We didn't have the problem of tests lasting forever. It was reasonable. It wasn't great, but it was reasonable. But the key is we were able to learn from our experience with the prototyping. And what I wanted you to get out of this is that if there's any way to get feedback in your project, if there's any way to learn from what you've been doing, you need to incorporate that as one of your lessons, right? Learning from what you've done so far in the project really helps. Now, I actually, before I knew about Agile life cycles, had been using incremental life cycles for years. I actually started my first incremental life cycle project in 1984. I was working on a machine vision system that was going to be installed in Detroit. It was a windshield inspection system. And I had no clue how to do the work. None whatsoever. We had to make algorithms up from scratch. I had to get a new camera. I had to light the thing differently. I tell you, when I tell you I had no clue, I really mean it. This was not going to be an easy project. So what I said is, first, I'm not going to try and get all the requirements. I'm going to try and get some of them. And then I'm going to figure out what my architecture might look like. So I have a framework in which to fit things, because I still thought at the time I needed to have an architecture first, because I was kind of stupid, right? That I like to do features and then build the architecture, but everyone said, no, no, no. You probably don't remember, but the 80s were the decade of top-down design, top-down structured stuff. None of you remember this, sorry. Okay, I have more gray hair than you do. I know, I'm proud of this. But then I moved into doing the specific design code integration and test for feature by feature. And I found that that actually worked fairly well. Now you'll notice that these are different sizes of design, code, integrate, and test. So I was working on features, but I didn't normalize the sizes. I wasn't working in time boxes. And I did have to do a final integration. And because I was attempting to test my own code, I finally gave up on that and said, okay, I need a final test from somebody. You, come, test my thing, because I'm not very good at it. And so, but this was a relatively successful project, and I delivered something in less time than the customer expected, right? And so an incremental lifecycle for me was a very helpful lifecycle, and I used it for many, many years. This one is actually called stage delivery, because you can see that because you're designing, coding, integrating, and testing as you go along, you could deliver after you finish a feature or a feature set. Right? It's not the time boxes that Agile gives you, but it's useful. And what I found is that by putting together pieces of the system, I could really see how the system would take place. I could see what it was going to look like. I could get a little vision about what was going on. And I happen to really like that. Again, it's feedback for me as a developer. Now, in the Agile life cycles, and I'm just lumping them all together here, the idea is that you do some requirements gathering and a little bit of planning, but you only have to do as much planning as you need to get through the first time box. Because while the developers and testers and the technical staff are working on the product, trying to deliver running tested features in that time box, the product owner can be re-ranking and determining more requirements. Right? So you don't have to know everything about the system to get started. And what I found with using the Agile life cycles is that this allows people to get started when they really don't know how to get started, right? There are some of you, some of you who might have been in my class on Tuesday afternoon, someone said, I don't know if that person is here, well, can we have a first iteration of design or a first iteration of architecture? And my response is, no. I want to see you develop something, because I don't think you can possibly know what you need until you have something you can look at. You have to make this ephemeral software, this highly complex product, tangible, visible, right? You want to be able to see something with it. And that's one of the beauties of the Agile life cycles. So when I say that there's a bunch of life cycles from which you can choose, you can actually use chunks inside time boxes in any life cycle, right? Just because a life cycle is a model doesn't mean you can't use useful practices, right? And maybe chunks inside time boxes is not a useful practice for you, but it could be for the person sitting next to you. Although I have to admit, I really like chunks of work in time boxes. In case you're wondering, time boxes are not a new approach for projects. Time boxes have been around for a very long time, mostly because we're human. And you've heard of Parkinson's law, work expands to fill the time allotted. Well, sometimes you have too much work in a set period of time. But more often, because we don't know how long things take, if we're not good at estimating, we estimate 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks. And then what happens? You may not have heard the term, but there's something called student syndrome. And if you have any teenagers, like I do, you are quite familiar with student syndrome. Student syndrome says, when you get an assignment from your history teacher to write a 10-page paper, you wait until the night before it's due to start. Right? That's past the time you needed to start it. We don't have that in our house anymore because mom is a project management geek. So what I have said to my daughters and what I've said actually to myself, I do this all the time, I work in 1 week time boxes. I decide what I'm going to do for the beginning of the week, and then I keep working down my list of things to do, and sometimes I estimate and I have too much for a week, and sometimes I estimate rarely and I have too little, which is fine because then I feel like I've, you know, gotten an extra day of work done. But the key is that if you start work when you need to start work, you can finish it and you can cross it off your list. And if you're a list person like me, and I suspect many of you are, there's a fabulous feeling of contentment, or at least happiness or something, when you get to cross things off your list. So chunks of work in time boxes are not something that only work for one kind of life cycle. They work for any life cycle. Now, you can't possibly read this. The serial life cycle is on the top. The agile life cycle is on the bottom. The iterative is just under serial. The incremental is just over agile. But here's the key. Not every life cycle is appropriate for every organization. And if you work in a highly command and control organization where the discipline is all in the management and project management, don't expect people to be able to use an agile life cycle. Because in an agile life cycle, the discipline is in the team. The team decides what they're going to do, how they're going to do it, when they're going to do it. The project manager just removes obstacles. But in the serial life cycle, and somewhat in the iterative life cycle, the project manager has to impose discipline on the team. I actually think discipline is the wrong word, but I don't have a better one. When I think of discipline and people practicing a craft or practicing an art, the discipline all comes from the person inside, right? So when I was taking piano lessons, I was the one who had to choose to practice. I was going to take that lesson on Sunday whether or not I wanted to. But if I wanted to do well, I had to practice. So the discipline had to come from inside of me. If I want to be a better writer, I have to practice writing. If I want to be a better speaker, I have to practice speaking. When I was working on my coding skills, I had to practice coding. All of you practice your work every day. And the discipline for how you practice it, how you get feedback, comes from inside of you. And sometimes your management wants to somehow impose that discipline on you. I actually don't think that that works particularly well, but in some organizations, it does seem to work better than the other way around. So my advice to you as a pragmatic project manager is to say, how much discipline do I really need to impose? Sometimes the answer is zero. In fact, frequently the answer is zero. People will live up to your expectations if you make your expectations clear. And then your job is simply to remove obstacles. Now, let me move on to the kinds of planning that I see. This is, you notice that this project starts, then there's not much planning. There's that flat line. And then there's this big plan. The top part of this is the initial planning, the things you do to figure out where you have to go. The bottom is the replan. And have you ever seen a write once, read never schedule? I have, and the scheduling looks like this. Something happens, the project starts, you do some amount of planning, and then people ignore the schedule completely until the end, where it's a disaster. And then they say, oh, we have to reschedule. We have to reschedule. Oh, it's wrong. So reschedule. It's wrong. Reschedule. Wrong. Right? And you keep doing this. If you've ever been on a project that lost a week every week, you've probably encountered the write once, read never schedule. I really hate that. I hate it for a number of reasons. I am probably one of the few project managers you know who has never successfully used a Gantt chart. When I started managing projects, I drew a PERT chart on my manager's blackboard in chalk. That's how old I am. Yeah. And then when I, and they didn't have project management, they didn't have Gantt chart scheduling tools on the computers that I was using when I started managing fairly large projects, but we had yellow stickies. And I thought, you know, I kind of like those PERT charts. I think we're just going to use yellow stickies on the wall. And I managed a number of projects, some of which were very, very large, using yellow stickies on the wall. I've been successful. I don't actually see a need to change. So when I schedule things, I don't do this kind of scheduling. I tend to use a different scheduling approach that I call it rolling wave scheduling or rolling wave planning. What I do is I do, and you can see that there's a bunch of scheduling at the beginning. There's also a flat line because almost always projects start before you think they do. Somebody's doing something and the project manager is not there, and that's fine, right? They can do something and maybe you'll find value in it. So I do a bunch of planning with everyone in yellow stickies on the wall, and maybe we have to fix it. And then because I keep somewhere between a 2 and 4 week rolling wave plan, unless I'm using an Agile lifecycle, in which case I don't need to do this at all, as we move through 1 week, I add another week on. So I always have 2 to 4 weeks of schedule, of detailed schedule. Now, if you have a really big project and the people on your project are allergic to digital pictures, or you just don't think digital pictures are going to cut it, fine. You can put it into a Gantt chart if you really must. Just don't ask me to edit it because I don't have a clue how to edit Gantt charts anymore. But you'll notice that as the project progresses, there's less and less planning that you have to do, right? The modulation, the frequency sort of increases because you're in a rhythm, people know what they have to do, and the amount of it really damps down. So rolling wave planning, especially if you're not going to use an Agile lifecycle, if you're going to use something else for whatever reason, is one way to get a write often, read always schedule. Right? I want to review the schedule. I want the people on the project to understand what do they have to do now, and maybe what do they have to do a little bit of next week and the week after, because I want it very clear where we're headed in this project. And you'll notice that if things change, if I have some kind of a change, I don't have to ripple through a huge Gantt chart, which is going to make my date go out because you can't trust it once you make so many changes. And I don't have to do a lot of replanning. I do a little bit more often. And so rolling wave planning or rolling wave scheduling is something I hope you consider using because it's a really good idea. Again, if you use an Agile lifecycle, you in effect you do this rolling wave at the beginning of a time box, at the beginning of an iteration, and then you probably don't have to change anything in the time box, right? Because you know what you think the team can accomplish. You keep monitoring, removing obstacles, checking the velocity, and at the end, you do a demo and a retrospective and look at your data and say, well, where were we with our estimation? And now if you realize you have to, it's going to take you an extra iteration, that's part of your rolling wave planning. So you really don't have to worry much about schedules at all. Now, I told you before I really like prototypes, especially so that you don't end up with a PowerPoint architecture. By the way, I believe Andy Hunt and Venkat, whose name I cannot pronounce, developed that term in Practices of an Agile Developer. The idea behind prototyping is you want to see how the different pieces of the project fit together. And I have found that if you start with the architecture, you get lots of really pretty pictures, and you get stuff. You get a bunch of puzzle pieces that may or may not fit together. And I don't actually really like that, because here's what happens, especially if you get close to the end of the project. You're building across the architecture, which is just like building two ends of a wall, and then you can't figure out how to get them together. I don't know how many of you have ever seen roads being built from the opposite ends. I grew up in New Bedford, Massachusetts, and they took a whole nice little residential area and turned part of it into a highway. So they had to make the road from here and the road from here fit together. And it was a straight line at one point. And they got to about the last quarter or maybe tenth of a mile. And they realized what they were going to have to do is make a jig. Now, they'd already taken a bunch of houses by eminent domain. They'd already gotten money from the federal government. This is back in the 60s or 70s when you could still get money from the federal government. And they had to go back to the money people and say, we kind of screwed that one up. Our road did not meet in the middle. We're in big trouble. That's a lot of what happens when you try and define the architecture and when people try and implement by architecture instead of implementing across the through the architecture to implement features. Now, one of the things I really like about implementing by feature is I can tell whether or not the feature is done. And let me say something to you that I sort of just realized this last week. Customers don't buy architectures. Customers don't actually care about your projects. Projects are a way for you to organize your sets of features. Customers buy features or sets of features. Testers test features. So for me, it really makes sense for developers to implement by feature, right? This is something that makes sense to me. And if I can say, hey, this thing is done, as in really done, not it's done for me and works on my computer, that's not done. That's coded. That's something. I want to know that it's working on all platforms. It's working on all databases. It's been checked in. It's been tested. It's been reviewed. It's been whatever it is that you need to know it's going to work. And when you implement by feature, because you're working in smaller chunks, it's actually much easier to do this. It doesn't matter what lifecycle you use. You can implement by feature. You do not have to implement by architecture. It doesn't matter what lifecycle, you don't have to do it. Now, for those of you who haven't seen my really pretty picture, this is what implementing by feature looks like. It's not clean. It's kind of messy. It might wander around through the code base. And that's one of the reasons, oh God, okay, I'm going to probably offend all the architects in the room now, right? Okay, if you're an architect and I've offended you, I'll buy you a glass of wine later. So if the architects don't like it because it's really hard to define at the beginning those places where you want to know what is the interface between the GUI and the app layer, or between the app and the middleware, or between the middleware and the platform. How do I know where all those components fit? And you know what? You can't possibly know that until you've implemented some features and seen what it really looks like. Now, this is where I thought I was an idiot back when I was a developer, because I couldn't put together an architecture. I thought there was something wrong with me. Ha! Everyone else was just faking it. So, now, that's not true. There are some brilliant architects who really are not faking it. They really do see all these interfaces, but there are many fewer of them than they think there are. So it's really kind of a problem. Now, I did say that no matter what, you should not be multitasking. And then, of course, I had to say, unless you're a manager, unless you're a very senior technical person who answers questions across the organization. So yes, this is context dependent too. However, I do think our managers would make much better decisions if they were not multitasking all the time. And I think our technical leads and architects and senior technical people would make much better decisions if they were not multitasking all the time. Because this is what happens. You start off with just one thing to do, and maybe you have to wait for something, right? You ask someone a question, you don't have all the answers. So maybe you take on more work And now you get into wait states on two different projects. And then what happens? You end up cracking at some point. The story I told earlier today is one of my bosses really liked to give me work, saying 50% on the first project, 35% on the next project, and 15% on the third project. But almost no one actually works on the third project. Rarely do people who want to get stuff done work on even the second project. And those of you who are actually trying to multitask on several projects, I doubt you're getting anything done at all. The interesting thing is that if you're working in a serial life cycle, none of that is apparent. It's all hidden until you get to integration and test on the schedule. Right? It's completely obscured. There's no way to even know about it. However, on an Agile project, you know this right away, because someone says, well, at the stand-up meeting, I haven't actually finished anything since last Tuesday. Oh? And it's very important not to say, oh, you idiot, because it's not that this person's an idiot. It's, oh, what happened? That's an obstacle that the project manager needs to remove. So it's very important to understand what happens with multitasking. You don't get more work done. You get substantially less done. And the problem is that your managers don't know this because all they do is multitask. That's how they come to work every day. It's what they do. So I would like you to think about how to say no. And we have, we have a little time. I'm going to run a little yes-no clinic. So I would like all of you to stand up for the moment. Okay, here's a man who does not need help. Could you please? Thank you. Now, I would first like you to say, yes.
Yes.
Okay, with more fervor, please. Yes.
Yes.
Oh, that was excellent. Now, I would like you to say, no.
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 Okay, so we've established that you can actually say the words. This is you can't sit down yet. You need a little exercise. This is Vegas. All you've done is sit and listen, right? So what I'd like you to do now, and I'm going to time you for about 30 seconds, is walk around and say yes to anyone that you see. Go ahead, 30 seconds. Okay, stop where you are. Now I would like you to say, that was only 20 seconds, by the way. I would like you to say no for 20 seconds. Say no. Okay, stop there. Now I will give you 20 seconds where you can choose whether or not you say yes or no. So this is your choice. Go ahead, 20 seconds. Okay, thank you very much. You can sit down now. And I would like to do a quick debrief. What was it like for you to say yes to people? Easier? What else?
Pleasant?
Stupid? Oh, I'm sorry. Was it fun? Yeah, yes, thank you. What was it like to say no? Someone said pleasant? Because you don't get to do it very often. What else was it like? Refreshing? Scary? Yeah. What was it like when you had to choose? Really scary.
You immediately want to say no.
Right, so kind of combative is what this gentleman said, because if someone says yes to you, and then you immediately say no, it's like, you know, what's going on? So the, and of course, this was completely context independent, right, which is not what's going to happen at work. At work, you have a context. But one of the things I hope you get out of this little simulation is that there are certainly ways to say no. I'm not going to talk about them in this talk. And that you have many more options than you might think you have. Because if you could say no to a perfect stranger, is it easier or harder to say no to the people inside your organization? For some of you, it's easier. For many of you, it's harder. I have a husband who hates to say no to me. But he's learned. So it's very important, because otherwise, see, this is the key. If you always multitask, you have never made that commitment. You've never taken that step to actually deliver the work. You have sort of one foot here and one foot there, and I promise you I am not going to teach you to rumba or cha-cha. But it's very important that you not dance around this problem, because the more you multitask, the less you get done. And that's just not acceptable. So I wanted to try and summarize some of my lessons, that if you use a life cycle that matches your project's risks, right, the serial life cycle was supposed to manage cost risks, but turns out not to manage any. The iterative life cycle manages technical risk, but does not manage schedule. The incremental life cycle manages schedule, but not technical. And the agile life cycles actually manage schedule, technical, and cost risk. That if you plan to replan, you will not run into the write once, read never schedule. You will have a schedule that makes sense for your project. That if you learn from the work by prototyping, implementing by feature, you can use some of the prototypes or the feature-based work to get feedback about the project to move back into what it is you have to do to replan for your project so you can make it successful. And that there are several ways to say no to multitask. We just chose the one simple way of saying the word no. I want you to have to avoid those dead lines. I don't want you caught outside that 14-foot boundary. I want you to have successful projects. And one of the ways you can do that is by thinking about some of these things and hopefully taking some of those lessons. I thank you very much. It's been a pleasure, and I hope you've had a wonderful week at Better Software. Thank you.